Imagination, in the proper meaning of the term, made no part of Wakefield's gifts. Nathaniel Hawthorne, Wakefield, 1835.
Highbridge Audio presents Wakefield by Andrei Codrescu. Read for you by Jeff Woodman.
Prologue. Late in the 20th century. One day, the devil shows up.
I've come to take you.
I'm not ready, says Wakefield.
Why not? You don't have any reason to live.
Wakefield is scandalized. Are you crazy? What kind of a thing is that to say to a man in the prime of life?
You're a failure. Time to die.
The devil's bored. He's had this argument, what, 6-7 times a day? Nobody welcomes death. They're ready for it. They need it. But when it comes right down to it, they won't go. What do you mean, a failure? I'm quite well respected.
All right, sighs Satanic. I'll play the game. Why do you want to stay? Worried about the people you'd leave behind?
I have no interest in people, Wakefield pronounces haughtily, drawing himself up and looking down on the thinning fur between the horns of the unholy one, who's actually fairly short. I just want to be left alone. He tries to slam the door in the devil's face, but the devil's got a hoof in it.
Okay, so you're a loner. No loved ones, no next of kin, no pets. Nothing to live for but a few bad habits.
That's not what I said. I've got lots of friends. Wakefield sounds doubtful. My daughter Margot would probably be very upset. The devil sees an easy shot and takes it.
Don't kid yourself, buddy. You haven't seen your daughter in years. We both know that. Tell the truth. What's the real reason you want to stick around?
The bit about the daughter is unfair. He talks to Margot on the phone every 2 weeks. He's not a model father, but he's no deadbeat. Well, actually, there's some reading I'd like to do, Wakefield improvises, gesturing to the crammed bookshelves that line the walls of his garret.
That's a real thigh slapper. You can read when you're disembodied, nothing to stop you. But I haven't got all day. You've read enough already to know how it works.
Wakefield does know how it works, in books. You keep the conversation going, keep the devil talking until you find a way out.
It's like this. I honestly wasn't expecting to see you. Couldn't you give me another chance?
Wakefield puts on his most sincere expression.
I've had this feeling for a while, you know, like I went wrong somewhere, like maybe I should have lived a different life.
Oh, sole mio, I hate the bookish ones. It ain't like reincarnation, friend. I don't know anyone who thinks they've lived the right life. They all think it's been some kind of dream. I have only one question. Do you believe in me?
This is important to the Diablo. He's obligated by an ancient professional code to give believers another chance. Unbelievers, he just scoops up and closes the book. If you don't like it, contest it in court. The afterlife is one long hearing.
Oh, I believe in you. Don't get me wrong. I read somewhere that there's a black hole at the center of the universe, some kind of supermassive gravity not even light can escape from. That's you, right?
Sure, that's me. There are a lot of us, actually.
So, don't you have to give me another chance, if I believe?
El Malefico rolls his eyes at the stars, where his dark-bearded masters sit around the fire eating the souls he's brought them.
Don't tell me. You got that from a book, too.
Yeah, well, what do you say? Can't we make some special arrangement? I'm not the most demanding of men, to quote Frank O'Hara.
The devil's lower back is beginning to bother him, standing in a drafty doorway like this.
You'd think I could sit down for a minute, pal? I'm under no obligation, you understand, but we could, perhaps, discuss your request.
That's more like it, thinks Wakefield, ushering in his guest.
Maybe I could get you a drink. I know I could use one. What'll it be?
Scotch,
grunts the devil, easing himself into a plump leather armchair. The cell phone in Wakefield's pocket has been vibrating at intervals throughout this unusual encounter. While he prepares the drinks, he listens to his messages. There's one from his lecture agent, urging him to take a gig for half his usual fee. His friend, Ivan, his only friend, inviting him to a poker game. His broker, trying to sell him shares in a new IPO. And his ex-wife, Mariana, who wants to talk about their daughter. Wakefield pours his own drink extra deep. The devil, meanwhile, is checking out Wakefield's digs.
The guy's got good taste for a schmo,
he thinks, admiring the Murano chandelier, the faded kilims, the three fake Netsuke in pornographic poses on the mantelpiece, next to a few family photos, a woman with bouffante, a man in Sunday suit, a boy with baseball bat. Bought at the flea market, like most families these days. He's got a soft spot for fakes. The devil himself has a collection of family photos from the offices of middle-aged men he's collected at their desks. He had taken the men first, then, for his own pleasure, their family pictures. Invariably, these turned out to be fakes, props, simulacra of real families, which is what made them desirable in his world, where value is based entirely on the differential between the fake and the genuine. The bigger the lie, the greater the value. The phony photos left no doubt he'd scooped up the right souls.
I think you'll enjoy this whiskey, says Wakefield, returning with their drinks. It's a single malt, a gift from one of my fans.
He takes a seat opposite the dark one, who sips the scotch and nods his approval.
I haven't been the best host, have I? Wakefield goes on, just talking about myself, what I want, and so on. What about you? It can't be easy, wandering the earth, always on call.
Wakefield's phone vibrates again, and the buzz is audible in the quiet room.
Turn that damn thing off, will you?
Noise drives me crazy,
the devil growls, swallowing the rest of his whiskey in one gulp.
You're the one with the supernatural powers. You turn it off,
blurts Wakefield, forgetting his manners.
I'm sorry to disappoint you, the devil says apologetically, but I have no power over cell phones, computers, cable TV, satellite communications, or microwaves. No, it's true, really. Things used to be more simple, more fun. I enjoyed a frivolous and pleasant existence as a beloved comic, quasi-fictional character. It was great. Classic literature, opera, ballet.
He sighs deeply, then leans closer to Wakefield.
Then, one year I went from being revived at the Bolshoi to being deified by Khomeini and Falwell. Since then, it's been a mess. A bunch of religious freaks spouting tacky rhetoric, demanding apocalypse-size work. I don't want to play world ender for these lunatics. I was looking forward to a lighter quota, maybe some R&R in the arms of a kinkishly altered soprano. And now you're giving me shit.
Wakefield is astonished by this outpouring. Who knew the devil had such middle-age problems? Poor old Pan, weeping in his mossy cave as the blinding light of a neon cross invades his darkness and his joy. Wakefield, too, regrets the passing of the pagan era and could almost hug the old goat, but he's got a deal to make.
How would you like an opportunity to cut down your workload and postpone some of that heavy eschatological lifting? Give me a chance to find my true life. If I succeed, and you'll be the judge of that, of course, I get to go on living. If I fail, well, you do what you have to do. It would be a hell of a lot more relaxing than smiting and scourging on a massive scale.
The devil is tempted. In his profession, gambling is the only way to pass eternity, which just doesn't pass, and is subject to multiple interpretations and migraines.
How long do you figure this business'll take?
The Dark One asks, putting his hooves up on the low table.
Oh, I don't know.
Wakefield pretends to calculate. A year, maybe. 2 years max. The devil is toying with his empty whiskey glass.
Wakefield fetches the bottle from the kitchen and pours them another stiff one.
It would have to involve some travel, you know. You can't just stay in this apartment and luxuriate. Nice place, by the way.
No problem, Wakefield hastily agrees. I travel a lot in any case.
The sucker's going for it, he congratulates himself.
The devil falls silent, savoring the second whiskey. He closes his tired yellow eyes, and for a moment, Wakefield imagines he's asleep until he grunts and his eyes flutter open.
And you'd have to bring me something from every place you go.
Bring you something? Like what, a souvenir? Something valuable? Some kind of sacrifice?
He's trying to be cooperative.
Can't say, really. Something you think I'd like. Could be anything.
Are you sure you don't want something more abstract? Isn't it customary to take my soul in this kind of exchange?
That's how it works in Faust, The Master and Margarita, all the classic texts.
Give me a break, the devil groans. I'm drowning in souls. It's a buyer's market. Look out that window and see for yourself.
A line of young women stretches out of sight down the sidewalk. Wakefield knows what they're waiting for. A famous director is shooting a movie in his neighborhood, and the girls are there to audition. The director has already cast the role. The audition is just a way for the old guy to get some nookie. Wakefield sees the devil's point. So, you really don't want my soul?
You're assuming, dear sir, that you have one. But whether you do or you don't, I don't want it. I want a thing. Pure thingness. Something that proves you found this so-called true life. Beyond that, the vortex of terror and self-doubt my simple request has created in you is adequate compensation. We have a deal, Mr. Wakefield, if you agree to these terms. I'll give you 1 year. It's an outlandish opportunity, but now that my existence has been proved by the discovery of black holes, I can afford to be a little generous.
Wakefield considers the practical aspects of his journey.
What about all the people who depend on me? My ex-wife, our daughter, the credit card companies, the people listed in my cell phone.
They won't even notice that you're gone.
So, when would this spiritual scavenger hunt begin? Wakefield asks, sounding more relaxed than he feels.
You must listen for the sound of the starter pistol, says the devil super mysteriously, holding up his empty glass. But for now, you can pour me another drink.
Part 1. Old Quarter. Wakefield lives alone in the old quarter of an indulgent port city known for its vigorous nightlife. It is, in fact, nighttime now, a rainy night about 10 o'clock, and Wakefield has just concluded his deal with the devil. Energized by that encounter, he grabs an umbrella and, as is his habit, heads for the corner bar, his home away from home. He bumps into a mob of tourists obstructing the sidewalk. They're clustered around a caped guide, leader of a ghost tour. They look sad, wet, lost, and a little scared. Adhesive badges identify them as members of the group so that non-paying customers can't attach themselves to the tour for free. All the tour guides in the city have their own stories, and ghosts to go with them, and they're fiercely, even combatively, competitive. Rumbles can break out between the costumed guides, and often do. Silk-caped vampires attack other silk-caped vampires, and tourists sometimes get hurt in the process. Ordinarily, Wakefield avoids these groups like the plague that they are. This guide seems to be pointing directly at him, but Wakefield knows that the gesture is meant for the building behind him, the city's first ice house, now a hotel, where the ghosts of Confederate soldiers make frequent appearances. Some of the tourists have rooms in the hotel and yelp with delight at the guide's revelations. Others stare at Wakefield as if he's a ghost. He evades the gawkers and quickly arrives at his destination. Ivan Zamyatin, Russian emigre cab driver and unknown American philosopher, is sitting at his usual post in the bar, at a window open to the street yet shielded from the rain. He can be found in this place most evenings after 5. The bar is his living room, just as his taxicab is his office. Wakefield closes his dripping umbrella and takes the stool next to Zamyatin's.
Have you ever read any Hawthorne?
Wakefield asks his friend by way of greeting.
I know the House of the Seven Gables and the story Young Goodman Brown, about this poor young man who meets the devil in the forest, and there is a witch's Sabbath, and everyone in town is involved.
No, not that one. There's this other story about a guy who leaves his wife and home, and everyone thinks he's dead, but he shows up again after 20 years. No explanation, no questions asked. Zamyatin scratches one of the luxuriant sideburns that descend from his bald pate.
In Russia, if someone disappears, everyone knows what happened. KGB picks him up and ships him to Siberia, if they don't kill him on the spot.
Wakefield gives his friend a sideways look. That's not the point. This guy was living in England, a democratic country where they respect privacy and the rights of individuals. He wanted to split, and he did it. And then he came back. Period. End of story. Ivan is not impressed by people who disappear voluntarily, having himself been disappeared by the state, first for 6 months in a mental institute. After that experience, he had worked for 5 years below the Arctic Circle, but he didn't regard that quasi-solitary episode as a disappearance. It was more like a gradual re-entry to the world. In America, he had purposefully shed his taste for solitude.
You know, he says, looking deeply into his vodka, I smoke in restaurants, park my taxi by fire hydrants, talk to everyone I meet. I leave many clues so people can say, Ivan was just here a minute ago. I gave him a parking ticket. I talked to him at the bar. He's alive. He's okay. Not like Russia, where it's poof, gone in a New York minute.
Wakefield is silenced for a few minutes by this undeniable wisdom, typical of Zamyatin. The devil showed up today, he finally says, knowing he can trust Ivan with anything, no matter how absurd.
What you talking about the devil?
Ivan looks disgusted.
Don't be stupid. We Russians are sick of the devil. He did enough for us already. I come here to get away from devils. You, a rich American, not too ugly. You have money to eat out, go to a show, anything you want. What you need the devil for, or God, or any of that stuff?
Zamyatin has no time for devils. He's too busy leaving his mark on everything, filling space with smoke, noise, lewdness, strangers. If a witch tries to eat him, all the people he met, maybe just once but marked real good, will come to his defense. Wakefield is quite a busy man himself. He's a travel writer and a lecturer on almost any topic, including travel. He often lectures in places he's already written about, giving the natives a quaint outsider perspective on their familiar world. Maintaining a trademark naivete, he will discourse on anything: life, money, art, or architecture. His subjects are not at all academic to Wakefield. He has lived what he considers an interesting life, and his observations are based on experience. He feels that his insights make people better human beings somehow, and that he's contributing to the common good. And his casual air of knowing whereof he speaks gives him authority, so people trust that under the skin of the studious traveler there lies a beating heart. He's even developed a reputation as a motivational speaker, though not a typical one, far from it. He's not the type who helps people find their inner selves through juggling, for instance. There is something about Wakefield's point of view that's quite dark, even dispiriting, making it hard sometimes for his audiences to finish the salad, to say nothing of the infamous convention chicken. The lecture business pays well. Employers shell out a fortune to motivate workers, with the result that most employees are over-motivated and radiate so much positive energy that their companies are forced to grow to provide new, sometimes fictitious, outlets to contain this boundless enthusiasm. Some shrewd CEOs quietly seek out realists, even pessimists, to temper the aggressive good cheer. Wakefield's brand of motivation uniquely fits this latter need, and his schedule has become very busy.
How is the lecture biz?
Zamyatin asks, dismissing the devil from the conversation. Terrific, actually. There's a shortage of non-positive points of view, Wakefield explains, so it's a seller's market. I've heard that corporations are even importing speakers from ex-communist countries, where a non-positive perspective is the norm. Correct me if I'm wrong. Unfortunately, you imports don't speak English too good, and that makes it difficult for you to convey your bleak beliefs to a large audience. You could make a mint, Ivan, if only you were more intelligible. Ivan is used to Wakefield's provocations, but still, he bristles.
What's wrong with my English? Anyway, no fat cats want to hear what I think. Everything is shit. That's non-positive, okay, but you should also be happy anyway, and that's optimism.
He turns away from Wakefield and shouts,
Beautiful bartenders, 2 vodkas if you wouldn't mind. Optimism,
Zamyatin continues,
was the official product of communism. But the people couldn't eat optimism, so they became pessimists. God forbid such a thing should happen in America. We produce enough to feed everyone, and we need pessimists to make us feel okay about not being hungry. Here are the vodkas.
Zamyatin's English is evidently good enough to charm the bartendress, who has poured 2 huge shots. She sets one on a napkin in front of Zamyatin and sloshes the other carelessly on Wakefield's shirt. As she walks away, she wiggles her tiny blue-jeaned butt for the Russian and glares at Wakefield. It's hell in here, Wakefield remarks to her sympathetically, gesturing toward the crowd at the bar waving money to get her attention. He wants her to like him.
Hell's okay if you can keep up with it, she shouts back, pouring with both hands.
Ivan resumes the conversation.
I met a man in my taxi today. He said he was a money manager, so I asked him where I should invest. He said, buy a place in the country with chickens and goats. Fill the basement with soup cans and toilet paper. I said, that's just like Russia. I don't live there anymore. In America, everybody's making money on the stocks. This country believes in the future. He said it's all a scam, a bubble.
It's easy to make money in the market, interjects a grungy person who's been studying the jukebox. All you do is buy IPOs. I'm a musician, and with the money I've made, I've been buying instruments I only dreamed about back in Ohio. I have 2 E-Trade accounts, and I'm rolling in it.
Playing any music?
The vixen on the next bar stool asks, joining the discussion. She has a nose ring, a tongue stud, fioral tattoos up and down her bare arms, and a bursting sun on the back of her neck.
I'm making like $600 a day on E-Trades, but all I do now is sit at the bar and drink.
Me too, admits the musician, sitting next to her. But at least I've got the instruments. When I stop trading, I'll play some gigs.
They begin comparing tattoos, and their conversation becomes inaudible.
No pessimists here, Wakefield whispers to Ivan. They've got a future. Drinking at the bar and planning which body part to pierce next.
Meanwhile, they may fall in love like me. I'm in love with the beautiful bartendress,
Ivan bellows, kissing his fingers and throwing the kiss her way. People of the world, drop your schmaltziness. Wakefield suspects that love is dangerous. It makes people euphoric and delusional. Herman Melville wrote something to the effect that the universe was formed in fright by an invisible sphere of dread. Then Walt Whitman came along preaching brotherly love and New World optimism. They proposed these different visions of the universe, and ever since, he thinks with some annoyance, we have believed one or the other. He imagines Melville and Whitman bent over a crystal ball, watching at the moment of creation.
Evil, pronounces Melville.
Love,
effuses Whitman. Wakefield takes out his pen and scribbles this idea on a napkin. He'll work it into his speech on money and poetry with a detour in art, a speech he hasn't written yet, though he'll deliver it in less than 30 hours. Ideas always come to him randomly, from books, items in the newspaper, conversations overheard. I belong to the Ted Berrigan school of I can't wait to hear what I'm going to say next, he tells the people who hire him to lecture. Ted Berrigan was a New York poet and a genius talker who lived by a maxim attributed to another poet, Tristan Zara. All thinking is formed in the mouth. Zamyatin, meanwhile, is absorbed in watching two attractive women on the sidewalk studying a map. The street is atmospherically lit by the old-fashioned gas lights the city has recently installed in the historic district.
"Can I help you?" he calls to them. "I'm a taximetrist."
The women lay their map on the windowsill in front of Ivan. The rain has stopped.
"We want to know exactly where we are," one of them says. "I think we may be lost."
"You're tourists," thinks Wakefield. "Of course you're lost. It's your destiny. You're part of a sad, fantasy-eckle tribe that wanders the world looking for an excuse to return home as soon as possible. You're a pox, a plague, an obstructive cloud of locusts, a human wall of pot bellies and dewlaps." Wakefield despises the actual creatures, though without them he wouldn't have a penny to his name. He'd be an office worker, or an alcoholic slacker playing the market. The paradox doesn't bother him, though. Zamyatin actually enjoys tourists. He likes everybody, except the police.
"You are at the best bar in the whole city," Zamyatin tells them. "The martinis are incomparable. The people are very friendly, with the exception of this man here. I'm his only friend, but don't let that scare you. Come in and have a drink, and when we are finished, I will give you a tour in my taxi. Where are you from?"
They name a large industrial city in the gray middle of the country. Wakefield knows it well. They make tires there, and plastic, and eat pork sausages and drink beer. The women accept Ivan's invitation. They come in and pull two stools over to the window.
"What are you writing?"
one of them asks, picking up the napkin Wakefield's been scribbling on. Ivan's beautiful bartendress brings the ladies martinis and gives the Russian a dirty look. Wakefield, she ignores completely.
"Mel Witt looking into Chris Ball,"
the visitor reads from the napkin.
"Who are they, Mel and Witt?"
"They are a couple of guys waiting for chicks," chuckles Ivan.
The tourists laugh. They aren't lost anymore. They're at home in Zamyatin's world. One of them folds the map and puts it back in her purse.
"Our husbands are at the convention,"
she explains to the gentleman.
"Ah, the convention. There are three conventions in town right now. Dentists, geographers, and cardiologists. Which one?"
Ivan has been driving dentists, geographers, and heart doctors for 3 days.
"Dentists,"
sparkles one woman, showing her perfect teeth.
"We are dentists' wives."
They look pleased. Being dentists' wives on vacation while their husbands are stuck in workshops discussing the latest advances in the profession makes them happy. They're out at night in a lovely, historic city. The leaves are rustling in the darkly scented sweet olive trees. A golden statue of Joan of Arc is glowing in the park across the street, and a not unattractive Russian guy is flattering them in a charming accent. Could anything be better? Ivan shares their delight. But for Wakefield, it's not that simple. He imagines row upon row of dazzling white teeth filling a large auditorium. He's lecturing, ironically, about human evolution and tooth development. In the beginning, humanity had strong teeth and ate bark and roots. Then a chosen few grew fangs that pierced flesh. There followed a long, dark period of cavities, infections, death, medieval dentistry, wooden teeth. Then, the light. Anesthetics, fillings, scrimshaw, braces, aesthetics. In the future, he tells his audience, teeth will have computer chips in them, analyzing diet, giving advice, emailing the dentist at the first sign of decay. He receives a standing ovation.
"What's love got to do with it?"
Ivan sings along with the jukebox in his funny accent, and then he answers,
"Everything, my friends. I love the bartendress. She will make me 5 babies.
The Midwestern wives high-five him. "And one of them will be a new Stalin," quips Wakefield.
"In American parlance, you are a bring-down, Comrade Wakefield. When you are in love, you know the truth,"
the Russian says grandly, basking in the adoration of the tourist ladies.
"You mean he's a downer," one of them giggles.
Though Wakefield mostly tells himself everything, he won't admit that lately he's been feeling less skeptical about life. He's been daydreaming about working less and reading more, about regular walks along the river, having the New York Times delivered, indulging in a sexual adventure now and then. No wonder the devil walked right in. The dentist's wives, warmed by the martinis, are glowing, casting a golden light that gleams off the barfly's nose ring, Zamyatin's bald head, the gin bottle in the bartendress's hand as it hovers over a martini glass. Wakefield struggles not to feel optimistic. Optimism could wreck his career. The beautiful bartendress, whose name is actually Mitch, cashes out, her shift over. She drapes herself on Zamyatin's lap. On cue, the two tourists down their martinis and stand up to leave.
"What about the tour?" pleads the Russian.
"Maybe some other time."
Their teeth gleam.
"Bye-bye, be sure to see everything," mocks Mitch, waving the end of a braided pigtail.
"Mitchka," Zamyatin intones, "don't be jealous. I will tell you a story about Russian men. For 10 years before the end of communism, Russian men were becoming impotent. My friend at the Psychology Institute in Moscow studied the problem. He discovered that the future made them so nervous they couldn't perform. Only true love could make them men again."
"The future?"
Mitch wiggles herself into a position of greater comfort.
"I'm going to go back to school. I'm making good money now, but what about when I'm old? I'm thinking of studying nursing or web design. Yvonne, what did you do before you were a taxi driver?"
"I was an Arctic architect. Did you know that buildings in the tundra sink as much as 5 meters every year? So every year the second floor becomes the first floor. Eventually the top floor becomes the first floor, and everyone lives under the ground."
"Didn't Dostoevsky write something about that?" Wakefield feels the need to say, even though he knows it's lame. He's annoyed by the lovebirds.
"Sad profession, architecture," Zamyatin sighs. "Churches, sad. Big buildings, very sad. Official buildings, sad, sad. Wolves don't need architecture. Nature makes caves for them. Animals don't build anything except for birds and rodents, and they make nests from whatever they can find."
"Yeah, it's like my apartment," says Mitch. "I find things and I take them home, but I'll have to move soon because there's hardly any room for me anymore."
She whips her head around. One of her pigtails smacks Wakefield on the neck. The other gets tangled in the Russian's beard.
"Sorry."
She yanks her pigtail out of the scraggly salt and pepper beard and jumps to her feet.
"I've got to go wash up and get high," she says matter-of-factly. "I'm in hot pursuit of the better person I know I am when I'm high. Be right back."
"Please, don't wash," Yvonne calls after her.
"That'll be on your tombstone," says Wakefield.
"You're a tombstone," says Zamyatin. "A 10-story one and sinking rapidly."
The 10-story tombstone reminds Wakefield of something from the past, and he laughs. "Do you remember the Swede?"
"Do I? I can still see that red beard up in the air every time I take a leak. Everybody talked to him, you know. They confessed to him like he was a freaky priest."
Wakefield had met Zamyatin in the Arctic Circle, at the research station at Outpost Mountain, where he'd been sent to write a story for National Cartographic about the international team that spent 6 months there studying the feasibility of living and building on ice. Zamyatin was one of two Russian architects, the fun one. The other one was a tormented teetotaler who never spoke. Happily, Zamyatin made up for it by filling the endless Arctic twilight with extravagant stories. At the onset of winter, one of the team members, a Swedish meteorologist, died suddenly of a heart attack. Only a week earlier, his body might have been transported by air to Anchorage, but the winter storms had already started, and no planes could fly. At first, they kept the dead Swede just outside one of the tents, wrapped in plastic, but the wind tore the plastic away and nearly made off with the body. Then they slid the body into a sleeping bag, secured it with nylon ropes, and staked them to the ice. The wind tore the sleeping bag and all the covers thereafter, So the first man to make his way to the latrine every morning had to cover the red-bearded corpse again. After a couple of weeks, they ran out of things to cover him with, so they just scraped away the snow every few days to keep him from disappearing. Perhaps to reduce his creepiness, the remaining scientists created a playful mythology around the dead meteorologist, who became, among other things, a kind of father confessor. It wasn't unusual to find one of them carrying on an intimate conversation with the corpse, but then, of course, there was no need to whisper because the wailing winds were loud enough to drown any human voice.
"The shit I told him, I never told anyone,"
Zamyatin nods.
"My roommate in the mental hospital was just about as quiet as the Swede. I told him everything, too, but then the fucker came out of his catatonia and ratted on me. No, I really liked the Swede."
Wakefield had also liked him. He'd had his moments with the body, addressing it with rambling monologues about his wife, now ex-wife, Mariana. The Arctic night does funny things. He hadn't found it all that strange to sit there, wrapped like a mummy in the swirling snow, telling all to a corpse. In fact, all his conversations during those surreal months had been huge, epic, unequaled since. He and Zamyatin had spent 20-hour stretches discussing everything. For all that talking, though, what he remembered most was the profound solitude of the Arctic. All their millions of words fit in a thimble and vanished in the night. The memory of those days lifts Wakefield's spirits.
"I swear by the dead Swede's red beard that I'll get the better of you, Beelzebub."
The devil's weary face floats before his eyes, and he knows, with a certainty born on the spot, that his satanic majesty shares with him an inclination to loneliness. By the time he leaves the bar, Wakefield is already feeling freer. The little nubs of vestigial wings are already itching under the skin over his shoulder blades. All he needs to beat the devil is some imagination. Of course, imagination can be a problem in middle age. When he was a kid, the Rambo faucet was on full blast. Possibilities poured out of it, decked in colors like a dragon at Chinese New Year's. At 15, imagination slunk around like a mermaid in sequins, with a sex of fire. But soon enough, real bodies and sentiments got pasted onto his fantasies like labels, and imagining began to feel foolish. And now, it's as if he's been given a sabbatical from the life he'd long believed he was living. He's free to consider alternative lives. He decides to make a list of possibilities to exercise his wings.
1. What if... 2. Whatever happened to...
He tries to think more specifically.
3. What if, instead of her, was her?
4.
What if, instead of here, was there?
5.
What if I wasn't me?
6.
What the hell does the devil mean by that starter pistol?
His listing is interrupted by his cell phone, which, in this story, is never the starter pistol, though it is demonic. He lets the caller leave a message, then takes it out of his pocket and looks at the caller ID. Zelda. His best ex-girlfriend and travel agent. Zelda books the flights for his lecture tours. He calls her back but gets her machine. He's supposed to leave for the Midwest the next afternoon. Once upon a time, Zelda and Wakefield dated, as they say. Sometimes they actually went out, but mostly they stayed indoors because the relationship seemed cursed by unnaturally bad weather. Whenever they planned an outing, a sudden rainstorm or an unusual wind would mess up her hair, tear off his hat, collapse the umbrella. These events were so common that they called them WZ moments after their initials. After the 50th WZ moment, the joke got old. Zelda was then an associate professor of anthropology, and about the time the joke got old, her studies took her to Siberia. There, she met a young shaman, the youngest member of the Shaman Union, formed after the collapse of the Soviet one. He had magical powers, as real shamans do, one of which infused Zelda with an irresistible crush. She decided to stay on in Siberia, where the weather was surprisingly better than it had been on any of Wakefield's dates with her. One day she returned, heartbroken. Her shaman boy lover had been lost, hunting alone. His body was never found, but Zelda received psychic messages from him. One of these instructed her never to resume a romantic relationship with Wakefield. Zelda wrote an account of her Siberian adventure that was rejected by every academic publication she offered it to, even though she tried her best to keep the paranormal references to a minimum. She was denied tenure at the university because of her long absence and failure to publish. Zelda took this not entirely unexpected outcome in stride, and on the counsel of her ghostly lover, she purged the essay of academic jargon and published it as a paperback for popular consumption. The book was a bestseller. With the profits, Zelda opened Crossroads Travel and cultivated a select clientele of people interested in traveling to places where magic is still practiced. Crossroads Travel advertised only in New Age publications, and several cable networks featured programs with Zelda in exotic locales, communing with loincloth pygmies or saffron-robed monks. Wakefield never took her special tours, but Zelda booked all his professional flights, which were mostly to very ordinary places. This service, which could have been performed by any travel agent, came with an educational component, however. For instance, when Wakefield complained that he didn't get enough exercise because he flew too much, Zelda gently lectured him.
"You have to change your perspective on everything, especially flying. Flying is your dharma, your karma, but it can also be your yoga. When it rained and stormed on us all the time, it was because of our inattention. I'm normally a very observant person, but something happened when I was with you. I lost my edge. Everything looked blurry, like I wasn't wearing my glasses. You always were the absent-minded type, which was charming for a while, but was annoying as hell when you stopped wearing your glasses. You also snore. Anyway, when both of us became inattentive, the universe responded with bad weather."
Wakefield listened to this analysis with growing astonishment until he had to interrupt. "But, Zelda, why in God's name would the universe care about us in such an attentive way? Rain and wind drench and smack everybody. Do you mean to say that all the innocent bystanders to our moments were victims of this attention by the universe?" Wakefield rarely invoked God, but it seemed appropriate.
"I can't explain this, Wakefield," she said impatiently. "But I'm convinced that the only way for you to become more focused and more observant is to be confined in a small place with a narrow field of vision where you can't move very much and have limited opportunities to complain. A place where you can go deeply into yourself and think beyond your usual parameters. If you just learn some simple breathing exercises and some minimal physical ones, you'll evolve so fast it'll scare you. That airplane seat is your yoga mat, Wakefield. Flying can be your yoga practice. Now, let me teach you some breathing exercises."
Wakefield had declined her offer and left her office in irritation. It started raining as soon as he was out the door. He arrived home soaked. After a few drinks and a long phone conversation with Ivan Reality Check Zamyatin, he decided to give Zelda another chance. The truth was that she was efficient, she knew his preferences, she had all his frequent flyer numbers on file, and she took care of rental cars, hotels, and whatever else he needed. He was too lazy to start over with someone else. So he invited her over one evening to begin his lessons. Zelda arrived wearing leotard and tights under her long coat. She sat in the lotus position, and Wakefield sat awkwardly cross-legged. She made him pretend that he was in an airplane seat, though he had never met such a full-bosomed, noisily breathing yogi on any airplane. No matter. He closed his eyes and listened. He held his breath and counted, exhaled and pretended to relax, visualized a bright lotus flower on top of his head, slowed his heartbeat, or thought he had, followed the path of his breath through his entire body, including his toes, let the light into his belly button, and generally obeyed every syllable of Zelda's instruction, hearing at the same time a familiar sound of sexual excitement that made its surely unconscious way between her syllables. He even tried, unsuccessfully, to temper his erection. His penis had never been a very good student. Surprisingly, Zelda's teaching wasn't wasted. Wakefield practiced on his next flight and the one after that. Soon he no longer felt embarrassed. He let his breaths in and out. He moved his body in small, often imperceptible ways and started believing in this flying yoga. It helped. It helped a lot. He did become more attentive, more careful, more responsive to the world around him, and not only when he was flying. He was grateful to Zelda and wouldn't dream of replacing her with an ordinary travel agent. He wouldn't mind sleeping with her, for that matter. That was out of the question, however. Ever evolving, Zelda had become a dedicated sapphist, as Ivan was wont to call lesbians. Her life partner was a beautiful but icy specialist in infectious diseases at the city's university hospital. Together, they traveled to spiritual sites and wretched parts of the world where the rarest infectious diseases rage. When Zelda calls back, he answers the phone.
"Take something warm," Zelda says. "It's 20 degrees and snowing up there. Do you even have a heavy coat?"
she nags, and Wakefield waits for her to quiz him about why he is going to a town called Typical, what the job is. When she doesn't ask, he volunteers.
"I'm going to Typical to speak about money and poetry and art to the biggest tech corp in the world."
Zelda laughs.
"What the hell do you know about money, Wakefield?"
"I know a lot about art, and I'm poetry in motion."
"You don't know a thing about anything, but you do know how to fake it. I guess that's your art. Too bad the pay is so mediocre. For such a great gift, I mean."
"Okay, Zelda, you've had your fun. Just give me the flight info, please." While she brings it up on the computer, he listens to her breathing. He imagines her breath descending down her throat, rounding her breasts, filling her Catholic-flamed heart, hurtling down her flat tummy, funneling to her pubis. He hears the voice of her red-haired assistant answering another line.
"Crossroads Travel, how can I help you?"
And he feels cozily enveloped by an odd kind of domesticity achieved by phone.
"Remember to breathe, Wakefield. We have a deal,"
Zelda reminds him, and the word deal evaporates his cozy reverie. Well, yes, Wakefield has made a lot of deals, and now he's made the big deal. Suddenly, he feels dizzy. The devil is lying at an angle on the roof of the cathedral, playing hooky from an important meeting. There's been an annoying increase in demonic meetings lately, and he can't stand the din of loudmouth upstart devils making huge deals out of all kinds of crap. The internet? Who cares? He's had internet since the beginning of time, and it doesn't bother him in the least that humans use it now. They'll never get up to the speed of thought, no matter how fancy their technology gets. He lazily scans the airwaves and picks up Wakefield and Zelda's phone conversation almost by accident. It worries him. Maybe he's made a deal with a shell without touching the nut inside. An unshelled chestnut is a favorite symbolic object for the devil, a lesson, really, about the mistakes even experienced demons can make. You mistake the wrapping for the entire package, and then, surprise, the shell falls away, and the innocent, shiny nut emerges. The whole point of making deals is to harvest souls that are no longer innocent. The payoff is the twisted object the world has made of a person. That's the art he collects. When he hears Zelda tell Wakefield, "Remember to breathe," a drop of cold sweat drips from between his horns and lands on his furry belly. If Wakefield hasn't yet learned to breathe, he may be unborn as well, innocent. The devil wipes his belly with his triple-jointed fingers and thinks for a moment about turning them into a long-barreled pistol and firing the starting shot. It would be so easy. Wakefield would see a brick fly out of a wall and land with a loud bang at his feet, or on his feet. There'd be no mistaking it. In a panic, he'd begin the race against time.
"No, not yet," thinks the devil. "Let him stew a while longer. Let him think he'll get the better of me. There's no way a fresh new creature, shiny with the foam of innocence and transcendent irony, is going to emerge from a middle-aged motivational speaker. Never happened before."
The devil grabs a passing leaf and puts it to his lips. He whistles through it, "I did it my way." A street painter looks up to see who's whistling. The leaf drops on his head. crossroads. Wakefield will find the crossroads and then take another direction. If he'd engaged the services of a shaman before Zelda left for Siberia to find her own, he might have improved the weather and saved their relationship. The thought makes him giddy. He could wave a magic wand of amnesia over Zelda and go back in time. He picks up Zelda after her class at the college. They sit outdoors at their favorite restaurant. Not a cloud in the sky. Over rigatoni, he hands her a ring. The ring doesn't fall into the noodles. They walk arm in arm to an after-dinner place for an after-dinner drink. Not a breeze. Nothing ruffles Zelda's shoulder-length tresses. His hat and tie stay on. They drink on the terrace. The stars appear, undimmed by city lights or clouds. The sickle moon stays screwed to its velvet pillow. They speak to each other clearly, lazily. No sudden gust of wind snatches syllables away. No cloud bursts on their conversation. They get married and sit on the porch of their little farmhouse, watching their plump baby sleep in his cradle. All is still. A rooster crows in the next village. A dog barks. He feels himself gag. What schmaltz! It's ridiculous, the road not taken, corny, and impossible. Whatever happens now will happen for the first time, and whatever choices I make will be the road taken, period. I'll never know if one way is truer than another. The devil is enjoying himself enormously. Part 2. Typical. In a large airport halfway to typical, Wakefield is looking to juice up his laptop computer. All around are others like him. There's one now, a little man with a goatee. His eyes roam greedily around the concourse, searching. Then he takes a few determined steps forward, then a leap, and he's there. He crouches, he grins, he opens his shoulder bag, and out come his cords. He plops down on his knees and plugs in his laptop and his cell phone. The devices begin to glow. He closes his eyes. Silence. The vampire is feeding. He's not alone for long. A young woman approaches swiftly. She acknowledges the other curtly, drops down, and pulls out her own vampiric implements. That's it for this particular feeding station. The outlets are full. Other vampires pass, disappointed. They've come too late. Feeding stations are few and far between. Vampires often must roam the length and breadth of an airport before they find a place to feed. Wakefield keeps hunting. An inconsiderate Lamia is using 6 outlets for as many devices. She's watching a DVD, oblivious to the world, the juice flowing through her. Wakefield curses her and moves on. At last, he spots an outlet under a dangerous-looking sculpture of something vaguely aeronautic. He leaps to it. His cord is out in a flash. He's in. He checks the glow light on his laptop. It's dark. Egads, it's a dead station. He looks around, momentarily disoriented by a sudden drop in his blood sugar levels. He sees another vampire grinning at him. That one knew. He tried it and failed, and now he's delighting in Wakefield's distress. Wakefield yanks the cord out roughly and resumes roaming, giving his co-creature the evil eye. You'd think our common need would give us compassion, but sympathy does not plague the individualistic, hungry beasts of the computer age. We don't share juice. Finally, at a deserted gate dangerously far from his connecting flight, he's able to feed. The moment he plugs in, he can feel the sweet juice flowing into his chips. He dials a faraway place, and the juice lets him hear the messages in his mailbox. Ex-wife, agent, attorney, Ivan. The icons light up on his desktop. Email invites him to grow his penis, enlarge his breasts, refinance his house. All is well in the world. Vampires pass by, hungry, needy, jealous. Let him pass. He has a full hour before boarding. Suddenly, Wakefield remembers a downside of his deal with the devil. In his year of grace, nobody'll notice that he's gone. How could that ever have seemed attractive to him?
If nobody misses you, you might as well be dead. Wasn't that partly why the other Wakefield, the man in Hawthorne's short story, left home? To see if he'd be missed. It was vanity. The guy wanted to feel important. Wakefield hugs his laptop, squeezes the cell phone in his pocket hard. Lord, protect me from what I want. I never want to hear that starter pistol. At home, Wakefield is master of his universe. Away from home, he's just a frequent flyer, an anonymous drudge, a chronically... What? Here's an announcement. His flight has been delayed. He's adrift among the hurrying, inconsiderate, demanding, pushy, self-absorbed crowd. No one sees him. Everyone is talking on cell phones, blindly pacing. He sends Zelda a bombastic email. Your familiars have failed. I'm stuck in the middle of nowhere. When the flight is finally called, he finds he's in a middle seat, squeezed between a large woman and a larger man. Their flesh spills over and under the armrests. By American standards, they aren't all that fat, but Wakefield prides himself on staying trim and abhors gluttons. He trembles as their tentacular flesh adheres to his sweater, sending unwelcome heat through the knit. After takeoff, the man turns on his laptop and a pie chart appears on the screen. Wakefield crosses his arms, but the man's elbow reaches past the armrest and pokes him. The woman shifts her thigh next to his, absorbing his leg. Americans get larger, the seats get smaller. It's demonic, seethes Wakefield. Blue jean manufacturers have figured out that the average American bottom has grown considerably, so why can't the airlines? Wakefield does the deep breathing Zelda taught him, trying to relax, then escapes into his book. He carries Mark Twain's Innocents Abroad for all his trips for precisely this purpose. In the 1860s, Twain went with one of the first organized group tours of Americans to Europe, Egypt, and the Holy Land, traveling by steamship and telegraphing his reports back to an American newspaper. Tourists, who live by guidebooks rather than by their senses, received their first entomological analysis at his hands. He nailed the pathos of tourism in its early bloom. Travelers' conveyances in Twain's time were at least more comfortable than your average commercial airplane. The same Grinch that has made it possible to work any time and anywhere via electronics has also been quietly shrinking personal space. Wakefield sinks ever smaller in his middle seat, balancing the paperback on his knees, but there's no escape from the waves of neighboring flesh. They keep coming, a surf of fat beating against the tender shores of his body. There's an active geometry of evil at work. While airplane seats are miniaturized, airport terminals expand to the size of cathedrals. Walking from the ticket counter to the gate has become a lengthy pilgrimage through soaring atriums and mighty temples of commerce, as if the space taken out of aircraft has been added to the airports themselves, just as nutrients flow at an ever-increasing rate from animals and plants into the mouths of greedy humans. The simultaneous machinery of gluttony and greed works to sacrifice the individual to corporate ego, imprisoning the body in a cell of fat, and every inch stolen from the body's ease ends up in corporate space. Once, there were luxurious staterooms on ships, lovely sleeping cars on trains, and airships with elegant lounges where thin women conversed with handsome men, sipping cocktails from crystal glasses. Travel itself was an enviable adventure, though of course only the wealthy could travel. The ungainly masses stayed home. What happened? When did change come? That's a no-brainer, thinks Wakefield. Two world wars redesigned trains, airplanes, and ships to efficiently transport soldiers, weapons, and prisoners. Efficiency became the ideal of design, and increased profit its overarching peacetime goal. Wakefield has the creepy feeling that this room hurtling through the sky at 37,000 feet is zooming toward a reality that will soon make his complaints completely trivial. The future, close as it always is, cannot be known. But Wakefield, listening with one ear cocked for the sound of the devil's starter pistol, can hear it whispering.
The lights of the runway blink feebly on the vast, dark prairie. The plane touches down near a frozen lake. Wakefield has arrived in Typical, headquarters of The Company, the largest purveyor of software on the planet. He's met in the terminal by Maggie, a company representative, and his escort for the next few days. She's blue-eyed and friendly, wrapped in an ankle-length coat, and her hand is warm from being cuddled by a mitten. Wakefield shakes it firmly and follows her to the parking garage. The wind blows fresh snow around, but Wakefield feels warm enough in his sweater, vintage overcoat, and the broad-brimmed felt hat he thinks makes him look like a gangster. Maggie's ice encrusted.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.